My name is Priyesh Devre, and the topic on our hand is project time management, or the subject information technology project management. We know time is very strict and it keeps on going, which is why the project managers face challenges to deliver project on time. Hence, scheduling is important for projects. Different people have different attitudes towards schedules. The different processes for project management are as follows. Let's look at the first one. Planning schedule management, it deals with policies, procedures, and documents to be used in the project scheduling and develops a schedule management plan, which gives the methodology used in scheduling, the rules for measuring performance, format of reporting, and involved processes description. Second one is defining activities in completing the project. An activity is a work element having a duration, a cost, and requirement. An activity with its attribute providing additional information is important for scheduling the project. A milestone is typically used to set schedule goals and is a significant step or event in the project completion. Third one is, after defining, we need to sequence the activities, that is, which activity will be performed after which one. It is done by determining the dependencies among them. The three types of dependencies are: first, the mandatory one, that is logically related to the type of the project, for example, the command to print and the process of actually printing. Discretionary dependency, that is the additional dependency defined by the project team to compress or fast track the project. Third is the external dependency between the project activities and the non-project activities, like the dependencies involving the labor union. For sequencing, network diagrams are used, which can be of either arrow diagramic method format or precedence diagramic method format. Arrow diagramic method format, as you can see in the diagram, represents activities as arrows, with nodes being the starting and ending points. Here an activity A has a duration of 1 day, and after that the activity D is performed, and likewise one activity ends and the second one starts. The project seems to be completed when all the activities, including the last activity J, is done. The other format is precedence diagram method format, which is more popular than arrow diagramic method format, and shows activities as boxes and uses arrows to show relationship between them. The different task dependencies in precedence diagramic method format are shown in the following manner. First, finish to start. The task B must start only after task A has finished. Start to start. The task D must start only after task C has started. Finish to finish. Task B must finish only after task A has finished. And start to finish, in which task B can finish only after A has started. Take this example. Activities A and D have finished to start dependencies. That is, A completes in 1 day on 3809, that is a day, and only after that can activity D begin on 4809. Likewise, for all other activities, project is completed after all the activities and the last activity J is finished on the date 24809. Now, the fourth process is estimating the activity resources, which are the quantities and the types of the activities required for completing the project. Some questions need to be answered here, like are the resources for the activity completion available? What is the difficulty in doing certain activities and organization's history in doing similar activities? Here a resource breakdown structure is used that provides the category and types of project resources. After this comes estimating the duration and the effort, that is, the number of working days required to do a task or an activity. Here, instead of providing a specific discrete number for how much time will be required, we use three-point estimates that includes, first, the optimistic estimate. It considers that the project will be completed without any problem or objection in the fastest time possible. Pessimistic, It considers that all that could go wrong in completing a project or an activity will go wrong, and project will take the maximum time required, and most likely is the intermediate to the optimistic and pessimistic estimates for project completion. Next, using the results of previous processes, we determine the schedule, that is the start and the end date of the project, in a realistic manner, done by using various tools. Let's discuss them. First is the Gantt chart, which displays the different project activities along a calendar with the starting and finishing dates. Like in this example, we have the different tasks in the task name column and horizontal gray lines for duration of the task with arrows between them for dependencies, and the black diamonds for showing the milestones. The calendar is displayed above. Second is the critical path method for predicting the earliest time by which the project gets completed with the minimum delay or float. This is done by considering the longest path and its duration in the network diagram, such that all the necessary tasks get completed. In the diagram, BEHJ, the path, has a maximum duration of 16 days. So it is taken as critical path, so that by that time all the other activities get completed and the project gets completed successfully. Now we have critical chain scheduling, which, as the name suggests, is very critical of the availability of resources. That is, it considers that limited resources are available and it includes buffers so that the project is completed on time. Also, it attempts to minimize multitasking, as multitasking can delay the completion of the project, completion of the individual task. For example, task 1 that usually takes 10 days to complete, in the case of multitasking, takes 20 days to complete. Critical chain scheduling uses Murphy's law, which states that if a negative thing can occur during a project completion, it will happen, it will surely happen. And also Parkinson's law, that says if allowed time for completion of the project is increased, work will be done in a way that the time is fully used and won't be completed prior to the deadline. To tackle this, project and feeding buffers are used, where project buffer is the extra time added before the project due date, and feeding buffer is used before the task on critical path. Last one is program evaluation and review technique. It is useful when there is uncertainty regarding the activity duration. It uses the probabilistic time estimates, that is the earlier discussed ones, optimistic, most likely, and pessimistic time. And it uses the formula using these probabilistic time estimates to give the time that must be used for a specific task while scheduling the project. For example, if the optimistic time for a particular task is 4 weeks, the pessimistic is 6 weeks, and the most likely time to complete the task is 5 weeks, then the PERT weighted average is, by the formula, is 5 weeks, which is the time that should be used while scheduling this particular task, according to PERT. Agile and time management, it involves defining work to be done in a short interval of time, that is a sprint, to produce a product in this time frame and getting customer input so as to bring customer collaboration and respond to any change in plans. The last process is controlling the schedule, which is done by performing reality checks, not expecting everyone to work at the full potential all the time, holding the progress meetings with stakeholders, and being honest about the issues in project duration and scheduling. We mean to find out the current progress, the status, and changes in the decided schedule. For this, progress reports, a change control system, and Gantt charts are used. So this was all about the project time management and the different processes involved in it. Thank you.